Wonderful. Next.
So I get to talk about one of my favorite topics, something that I've been kind of obsessed with for the last couple of years. And this is going to build quite a bit on what Carl and Paul just talked about. What is the value of a study, right? And not only what is the value of a study that exists, what is the value of a lack of study, right? What is the value of not having a study if we are in certain circumstances? And unfortunately, to talk about some of these circumstances in which we might get a lot of unreliable evidence, I have to talk about my least favorite topic in the world, which is unfortunately COVID. So we're gonna be talking about masks quite a bit here today. There's this really lovely quote by Dr. Adla Fredheim, who's a great colleague, about the Dan Mask 19 study. We'll talk a little bit more about that study in just a moment, who says, "Surely some trial evidence must be better than no trial evidence, must be." And I want to challenge that idea. What if, forget about trials too, what about any study? It is often the case that we might actually have a more valuable scenario in which we have no study. And COVID provides a couple of these. I should mention that Atla actually reviewed our rebuttal of his own paper and helped us rebut his own paper. Fantastic. So if you ever want to work with Dr. Fredheim, it's great. So part one, we have to talk about what something is. And the something we're going to be talking about is a lot of COVID. So most important topic in the world, COVID-19 policy. I don't think anybody would doubt that. What do we actually do when we have, you know, we're talking about NPIs, we're talking about all sorts of things. What do we do in the face of the pandemic? We want to make evidence-based decisions. And to know that, we need to know what the policies actually did to some degree. And when we say that, what do the policies actually do? What is their impact? We are making a causal question. We want to know what the causal impact of a policy is. There's a really nice little paper, and we're going to be going back to this quite a bit. Dr. Shen Wang is also on this, is the senior author, that asked a question. Among those policy papers, what is actually being cited? Is this high quality science? Is this highly cited science, right? And so what they did is they looked through all these policy documents, they gathered up all of, you know, whether it's, you know, an NPI or whatever it is, and they looked at the documents themselves and they looked at what is actually cited, and they took those cited articles and they looked for, you know, indicators of quality, in this case, proxied by citations and publication value. So just citations and just publication value. We're gonna come back to this. And of course, what they found is that there were an enormous number of studies that were cited in these papers. There are an enormous number of COVID-19 papers in general. And by and large, the papers that were cited in these policy documents come from the high, you know, these high impact journals, this New England Journal of Medicine, Lancet. They were highly, highly cited papers, among the most cited papers that there were. And they concluded that among the policy frontier, the papers that are in there are deeply grounded in recent peer-reviewed scientific insights, and that the scientific community itself was aligned with that. There was also in this high-impact space. We're going to come back to this statement in just a little bit. Because, of course, while COVID-19 policy impact was very important, it also has a problem. Causal inference is super hard. This goes in every one of my one of presentations these days. When I say that something is very hard, sometimes it might actually be intractable. So because often causal inference requires a set of extraordinary circumstances to happen. It always relies on untestable assumptions. There is no way to test everything in them. And it has kind of a weakest link problem at best. So it's not just that you can get 90% of it right. You have to get almost all of it right, because the one little thing that you miss can take it all apart, right? It's a very hard problem. A lot of areas have this, causal inference has it worse. And in COVID, actually, it's worse than a weakest link problem. So we wrote this paper about how do you actually review the quality of the methods in a policy review paper for COVID-19, because it's complicated. You have to include some things like infectious disease dynamics and so on top of normal health policy impact. There are all kinds of ways that this can go wrong and that interact in weird ways. So you have these weird stochastic time lags between when you actually pass some policy and when things start happening, right? You actually start seeing it in the data. You end up with these really, you have to have these wide time bounds because we're dealing with that stochasticity, right? So we need to, you know, we need to increase our time bounds, and that makes any linearity problems worse. So infectious diseases don't like to travel in lines. You know, at best, we have SEIR models that are all curvy and weird. We think about things like exponential growth and so on. And those are really, really important, and they exacerbate each other when you have, you know, multiple things going on at once. And of course, the really hard thing here is concurrent changes, because one of the really hard rules about causal inference is you have to eliminate almost everything else, or at least bound almost everything else. Nothing else can be going on. If you think about spring 2020, for example, everything was going on. Right? There's no possible way to extract one policy out of that. There just is not enough data. There just is not enough. There's not enough variation. There's just too much going on kind of all at once. Right? So we have what is fundamentally an intractable problem. So what we did is we wanted to say, okay, how much of this is actually an intractable problem? We want to actually review the methods. We want to look at these basic fundamentals, or at least a set of fundamentals that you would have to go through to have at least a minimally plausible, actionable, sufficient methodological quality that it is actually actionable, that you can actually use it. You should use it in a policy document. And we used a small set of criteria. We can go through them. And a little bit, you just saw them a moment ago, but just a couple of things, right? So we screened the literature, we went through nearly 1,000 PubMed hits, and we ended up actually with only 36. We're gonna come back to that. Only 36 is really interesting at the end. What we were interested in is policy impacts. So we wanted to know specific policies against some COVID-19 outcome, and a sort of direct comparison there. Only 36 is interesting. So what we did is we had this giant consensus process. We got everybody, you know, a whole lot of people together, 24 people, huge interdisciplinary team. It was an enormous amount of work happening in a relatively short period of time. We took this is about half of these studies. And we took all those and we gave them ratings for all of these four categories and an overall rating, bearing in mind that the overall rating is effectively a weakest link problem, right? So it only takes one of these problems to sort of sink the ship. And what we found was maybe unsurprising. Very, very few of these studies could get past this intractable problem. The thing that sort of sunk all of these ships was that you can't get rid of the concurrent changes. You have to be able to get rid of the concurrent changes. And because they can't, we don't have very strong evidence. In fact, it's arguably very weak evidence. So when we think about this quote again, yes. Absolutely, policy followed the science in some sense. But what science is it actually following? It's following studies that were more noise than actual signal, because they could not possibly have produced useful information for the most part. It's not entirely true. Most of these studies actually did have some useful information in them, but for the policy impact part, it was pretty much an intractable problem. So what about, that's observational causal inference. What about randomized controlled trial causal inference? So we're going to go to the Dan Mask 19 trial. This is a highly, highly controversial trial. I'm sure everybody in this room has heard about it at least once, whether you know it's nicknamed the Dan Mask trial. And what they effectively did is it's a giant trial. So they took about 6,000 people and they randomized them to one of two arms. And they randomized in one arm was the messages arm, in which you got a message to wear a mask and a box of masks. And then the other arm did not get the messages or the masks. So it is a mask messages versus not mask messages comparison effectively, right? So you can think about this kind of like an encouragement design if you're familiar with that, except they didn't do the IV part. You'll see why. And the primary outcome was they followed up with people a month later and they said, okay, who got infected with SARS-CoV-2? And that sounds great. 6,000 people sounds like a ton of people. And it's not. It's actually really small. So there's a whole lot of things going on at once, because we're talking about mask wearing versus mask messages, because that's basically what is feasible to randomize. You can't really randomize people to mask wearing. That's really difficult. You might be able to in some circumstances, but probably not. You might have some ethics complaints. And that means that we have sort of this two-step process. You get a message, and then you change your behavior, and then things are sort of happening. And the original power calculation really did not account for that, that two-step process. That didn't account for the fact that not everybody was going to be wearing masks all the time. it sort of accounted for a little bit of it, but it underaccounted for it. And then we have all kinds of other things. We have measurement error due to spillovers. That probably is a little bit small. We have measurement error due to specificity and sensitivity of the timing. That'll tend to bias things either towards the null or, depending on how you're looking at it, it'll at least widen stuff. And then we have test timings. We talked about that masked policy earlier. You know, it takes time between when you actually start wearing masks or you order people to wear masks to actually get results. And that's weeks later often, right? So you have to get, you start wearing masks, then you get infected, then you start getting symptoms, then you start reporting and so on. In this case, there was some, they can mitigate that a little bit, but we're really talking about in that 1 month period, you really only have probably a week and a half of actual active time. So there are not very many events. There's not much of a delta between the events possible between these arms. And depending on how you actually think about the estimate, if you're thinking about this like a mask trial versus a mask messaging trial, it'll be biased towards the null no matter what because of these measurement error issues, but it'll be way biased towards the null if you think this as a masking trial. And on top of that, it didn't measure some things all that well. So one of them is, that it didn't measure community spread because it can't. It's not a feasible thing you could do in a trial of this design, right? If you're doing an individual randomization, it just can't be done. And then it had one unforced error, which is it didn't measure compliance. And I say that this is the only unforced error because this trial at the time that it was done was the best that could be done properly, right? Some minor things here and there. You can maybe make it a little bit bigger, but this is the best that we had available. But the best we had available was virtually guaranteed by design to be non-informative and null, right? And that was recognizable by the protocol before the results were actually published. But of course, when the results were published, it was a non-informative null. And we had all kinds of headlines that said landmark age study finds no significant effect for mask face mask wearers. Later in the article, it sort of implies that there's no effect a little bit more. It talks about that this is the gold standard type study. One thing that's notable, a lot of people blame media on misinterpretation. One thing that's notable is that the author of this article is Carl Hennigan, who's the director of the Center for Evidence-Based Medicine at Oxford. Then you can go through the literature and interpretations of these things, and all kinds of academics will say roughly the same thing, right? It's not just a media problem, this is us. So that's what something is. That's the best something that we could do in these particular topics. Now there are dozens of these, I'm not gonna go through all of them. It's an extremely important question. It is the best feasible study that we could do, but these were not particularly informative studies, right? We didn't get much informative evidence out of this. And there's an extra trick, because if you spend the time understanding why these are not particularly informative, they contain very, very little information, then you know they're not informative. If you don't spend that time, you don't have that expertise, who really has that kind of time, and you sort of believe, you know, that some face value of this, then you have been partially misinformed. An uninformative study is typically a misinformative study for that reason, right? So these are worse than arguably nothing, maybe. They're also super costly to interpret and critique. I mean, it takes ages to look at even the four questions that we looked at in our systematic review. It is a wild process to get that done. It is hugely costly. It takes a ton of time. These studies are typically costly to produce, particularly that randomized controlled trial. And then you have to think about things like, you know, okay, we have ethics to the participants that are in there, right? What about also ethics to the scientific community who are in part getting some, you know, not getting very much information, maybe getting some misinformation. And then perhaps most importantly, what about the ethics to the people that are actually impacted by the decisions that are made here, right? These are big questions. Ethics is not just a review board. We have ethics for all parts of science. So that's something. What about nothing? So when I say nothing, I want to emphasize that I don't actually mean literally nothing. Nothing is sort of an option. It is the option to do something else, to sort of stop halfway and say, no, this is not good enough. This is not reliable enough. I'm going to move on with my, you know, my day or my career or something like that. It is an alternate use of resources. It is, you know, we're talking about opportunity costs more than anything, right? So that is nothing. And we have to think about, okay, what if we never had this trial, this giant landmark trial? What is the, you know, I'm a causal inference person, what is the counterfactual universe in which this trial did not exist look like? And so my colleagues and I argued that effectively we'd be better off on nearly every dimension, from informativeness to resources to ethics, the whole set, right? We are actually less informed having had this study overall. So nothing seems to be winning, at least sometimes. So this is to just show that that it is possible for nothing to be better than something. There are all kinds of arguments behind this. There's read Adler's article if you want a counter argument for this. It's a good exchange. It is useful. And of course, this is not a particularly radical idea. This has been around for decades. So the famous Douglas Altman quote, "Need less research, better research, and research done for the right reasons." Implicit in that quote, if we need less research, that means a lot of the research we are doing is probably worse than nothing, right? There are other interpretations of this. Maybe if we do less, then we can do everything better, and therefore, who knows? But that is more or less implied. So when faced with unknowables, we have a nothing versus something problem. And the nothing seems a little bit more honest. It uses resources better. It reduces clutter. So I work in public workshops a lot. And one of the key things about any public workshop, any wood shop in particular, the ones that work, don't take donations. They get rid of everything. They get rid of all the junk, right? Keep the place clean. The ones that stop working are the ones that started accepting donations. And then things start breaking. Then you get clutter. And then it takes a lot of time to find stuff. And when it takes time to find stuff, you get accumulating more and more and more junk. So junk begets junk. I'm not saying all these studies are junk, but keep that in your head as you're thinking about these things. It also minimizes misinformation, right? So some of these are arguably misinformative studies. It minimizes review shortcuts. So this is our systematic review that we showed earlier was a huge amount of time. A lot of times when you have these giant literatures, you have no choice but to do something really shallow. It's one of the reasons that tools like GRADE and Newcastle Ottawa that look at things that are very easy to measure, but don't really tell us much about the studies themselves are so often used, meta-analyses and systematic reviews and so on. And they're used as proxies for quality, or might see something like citations used instead, right? When the literature is that big, you have no choices anymore. It's just too expensive to deal with it. And it also clears the way for where evidence lacks, where it can improve, and what can be done next. So if we have a lot of studies that are sort of weak and misleading and so on, it can feel like that is good enough when it really isn't. And what we need to be able to see is the way towards what actually is good enough. And those have to be enormous, right? So they have, in some cases, in masks, they had to be, very literally tens of, hundreds of thousands of people involved to get a decent sample size for some of these things. But of course, the literature abhors a vacuum. So we have a selection problem. Because of course, the only incentive really in academia for the most part is more, right? All we want is more, particularly for the most important topics. The more citable the paper, the more people are interested in it, the bigger and more immediate the problem, the more unknowable it is. Because if it was knowable, you'd have a couple of papers and that would be done with it, right? You would know it already. An unknowable problem tends to create a vacuum. And of course, we want to be helpful. We're good people. We're smart, right? We want to help. And so we want to produce knowledge. And that's, we want to publish more. And of course, the more we don't know, probably the more we're going to produce, and probably mostly the worse we're going to produce it. And of course, this creates an adverse selection problem. So we're talking about systematic selection of science, like Paul talked a lot about earlier, because less isn't an actual option. Because what happens is if you understand why these are intractable problems, you spend the time, you carefully work through all of these things, you have reasonably high standards, you are concerned about the information environment, about ethics, about all of these things, you understand all of the flaws in these methods, chances are you're probably not going to produce the paper, right? And this was true for those that systematic review we talked about earlier. So by and large, this is going to sound strange, the health policy community did not produce those COVID-19 policy papers. A few of them were, most of them were from the medical field and public health. So the people that had the greatest expertise knew why not to do this. But the people who maybe had a little bit less expertise charged right in, right? We have a selection for, and those people got the citations, and those folks got all the career bumps and so on, while people who sort of knew better didn't, right? So when we have a hyper-competition for careers, we have we have these really, really severe adverse selection spirals that effectively select for, mediocrity, right? They may not select for the worst of the worst, but they're not selecting for maybe the best of the best. They're not selecting for this slow, careful science. There are also some weird other things. I'll briefly mention this. So there's an argument to be made that there are some interesting knock-on effects here because we can't ever publish nothing, we might end up with things like weird effects on causal language. So there's a good argument that to be said that, you know, when we say association instead of cause, what we're doing is we're actually just changing the question. We're sort of changing the appearance of what question we're asking while asking the same question. And so we're preventing ourselves from being able to actually critique ourselves. We're using this as a rhetorical shield rather than sort of the truth, because association is always tractable in health, but it's very rarely the thing we're actually interested in. We're almost always interested in causation, right? So we are changing an intractable problem into a sort of a pretend tractable one. And so this is from a paper we completed a little bit ago. It's going to be published very soon, where we systematically reviewed the causal, the language, the associational and causal language in an enormous amount, I think 1,000-something studies in epidemiology, public health, and medicine. And we looked at things like, okay, what was the actual causal, implied causal strength of the language, and then what was implied by the action recommendations, right? And what we found, by and large, is that there's a huge disconnect between the two. The action recommendations will tend to say, oh yeah, this is, will give you a causally based recommendation, but it's just association in the technical language. And that's arguably a symptom of not being able to produce nothing. So there are some alternative solutions. We could have nothing-ish, right? So we could do things like, we could have instead of actually producing nothing, we can produce studies that have public-facing, decision-oriented review, right? If you're a decision-maker, the first thing you should see about any studies is the study useful for decision-making, right? One sentence right there. And most of the time, we'll say no, and that's fine. There's nothing wrong with that. We're producing science. As long as everybody understands what we're doing, we're good. There is no problem. There's an alternative, which is you can do partial publication documenting. So instead of doing a full-on study, beginning, end, method, results, the whole thing, you can say, okay, this is what we explored. These are all the things we did. This is all the theory we thought about. This is what we tried, and here's what did and didn't work. And if nothing worked, we're documenting it. Please, world, see what didn't work so you don't have to repeat our mistakes. Or maybe you come up with something better. So these partial publications are something that could be really useful. And of course, we could have career advancement for doing less and maybe less better. You could actually pay people not to do stuff. So you could fund an entire field that has a lot of this problem, not all problems have it equally, to kind of wean themselves off of it and to think about other things. So like, kind of take a moratorium on publishing so much stuff. It might actually be cost effective to pay people to not publish, or to at least to pay people to do different problems. And the most important part is that we kind of all collectively need to get comfortable with an absence of evidence. A lot of our most important problems are non-tractable problems. That's why they're still important problems, because there are, right? And we're just not going to have the answers sometimes. So to close it out, I do want to go back to a key paper, Closet, about 2 hours ago, who said, science of science is interested in causality, right? That is one of the things. We actually want to know what causes what. So what intractable problems are we facing here? And I want to challenge you to think about, is what we are doing when we try to face these intractable problems actually better than that? Sometimes they're not.
Great talk. Can I put you on the spot and have you identify a subfield that we should pay not to do things?
Sure. So I
yours.
So the poster child for this is nutritional epidemiology. So it's the one, the sort of the standard example. The reason being, when you're dealing with these, any sort of behavioral change or just very like lifestyle based thing like diets and so on. That take 20 or 30 years to manifest outcomes from, there is really no way to disentangle those two in most cases. There's just no way that you're ever going to find the causal effect of chocolate on Alzheimer's. It cannot be done, right? Maybe somebody will come up with something cool later. So that's kind of the poster child, but not all fields have this problem quite as much. One of the things about the credibility revolution in economics is that it faced this problem pretty directly. It's not, it's not over, but it's one of the sort of rare historical examples in a field of sort of transforming the field and the evidence base due to this specific problem. of getting rid of some of a lot of the stuff that's intractable. Not perfectly by any means, it's an ongoing process, but there is sort of an, it is, you know, it does happen, it can change.
Yeah, I'd like to just follow up on that observation. Absolutely, I would say, and I'm not alone in this, probably more than half of most biomedical research should not be funded and should not be done. And it's the idea that you would, and part of it is the treadmilling problem, right? So if you were to say do less, that would be a field where I would say paying people to do less would be a great advance to society and humankind. Never mind the mouse community. So there is a field that I think really should take this challenge seriously and really think about what it could do. Because right now it's a jobs program, which is not really, I think, what most taxpayers are intending when they increasingly up the amount of NIH funding every year.
I tend to agree with all of that.
So I absolutely love this talk and I agree with most of it, but it's, I guess what I'm trying to understand though is the role of publication as a form of dialogue and discussion and communication. And so science as dynamic itself is a really important part. We publish not because we have determined a fact that in itself is completely certain, but because we're moving towards a cumulative aggregation of knowledge that we're discussing and critiquing and engaging together. And to do nothing, I think is actually really dangerous in that it doesn't stop people from going down unfruitful paths. It doesn't engage the community in what you know and your mistakes. I am just worried about that part that's lost in emphasizing nothing over something.
Yeah, I mean, if you can find a way to make sure that everybody knows the actual, you know, the strength of evidence of everything in the instant they see it, we have no information problem, we have no actual problem. So that's sort of the ideal way to deal with this. But there are a couple counter arguments to this that are, I think, very good. So one is that the purpose of a manuscript, the purpose of a publication is not to be right, it is to be a thing that people talk about, is an anchor point for discussion, right? And that's semi-plausible. I think that does happen quite a bit. That's important. It's also, you know, failures are progress, so we don't want to get rid of all bad studies. We want new failure, new kinds of failures. That is progress, right? That is great. We like new kinds of failures. And then people are worried about sort of people's, you know, inability to make decisions without having some sort of discussion anchor. I think that's totally legitimate as well. And maybe, you know, maybe the case that maybe the health policy community should have produced all of these papers, even if they knew they were not good, because they would be better than what was out there too. I don't find that one as plausible or as quite as satisfying, but they're all reasonable arguments against nothing.
So I couldn't help but be reminded of a conversation I had here at SFI right after the Great Recession, which was with a trader who was saying, this is after everything had blown up. He was like, yeah, I totally participated in that, because if I didn't even participate, then I would lose my job in the next 3 months because I would look worse than my compatriots who were plowing, you know, full steam ahead on all those risky investments. And so for the individual, the rational choice in this, whether you know, short-term relative loss aversion in a competitive environment dynamic, right? Like you don't want to fall behind your competitors, even if you know that what you're doing is the wrong thing. It seems like this is a dynamic that leads to herding and fads and bubbles.
Yes.
So is there anything that we can learn from like the financial and economic community about avoiding those kinds of dynamics that we could translate into the way scientists operate to also diffuse those? I'm not saying that they're successful at diffusing them.
I'm an economist, so yeah, we can talk about how economists fail to do stuff. Yeah, I mean, I think that sounds reasonable. I don't know that there, I don't have an immediate, you know, answer for that. I'm not a macroeconomist, so I don't, sort of bubbles are not my thing, but it sounds plausible. I mean, you know, the thing that comes immediately to mind is this super, super classic paper the Market for Lemons paper, Akerlof's Market for Lemons. That applies in all sorts of ways. It applies to careers, it applies for the sort of, you know, this competition down at the bottom for quality. has a fantastic paper. Everybody should read it. It is very short. It's lovely. And the rough idea is you get an adverse selection spiral because quality is difficult to actually measure. It is very, very expensive to figure out, but there are, you know, sort of outward signals of what a nice car might look like. Lemons is in cars, not lemons is in the fruit. And so you end up with this spiral of the incentive is to produce a car that looks like a peach, but is in fact a lemon. And then everybody expects that that more stuff is lemons, and then you get into this endless spiral with exclusively lemons at the end. And there's a good argument that is what we're sort of seeing here. Now, I don't think that all, by any means, the researchers are all lemons. That is, there are the other nice thing about the paper is it also describes social institutions as a way to combat that. Which is probably our best, sure, best weapon against that in science as well. But lovely paper, I'm pretty sure.
I feel like I'm actually curious what Carr think, because I think there is a kind of tension between his argument about like filtering this ex ante filtering versus this. It's so, have you thought about like kind of concrete way to incentivize? Like publication of like low quality work without hurting the kind of filtering process.
So I'll make the more explicit anti-Carl argument, which is, so Carl's definition of value involved, papers more valuable if it changes your beliefs more, but if we look at some of these studies that changed, if they changed your beliefs, you got misinformed. Or you didn't, you know, understand something. So that is not a high value paper. That paper that's maybe arguably a negative value paper, right? Is that a fair?
Well, I mean, I guess I'm assuming that people are able to adequately assess evidence. That's the and then updating is Bayesian. So those are the sort of core assumptions. If, you know, to the degree that in a lot of the problem here is that you have scientific, as you translate these scientific papers into policy papers into policy, you've fallen down on the job of assessing evidence.
Right. So yeah,
not you, but
yeah, you do. Yeah. I mean, assuming perfect information is, you know, a very economist-y thing to do, and it is a very bad science of scientist-y thing to do. So, you know, so we these things have enormous costs. I think that is one of the things that it's a cost that is not borne by the producer. It is a cost that is borne by the scientific community, right? It is an externality. And that is another, you know, a huge problem, because the person that is actually producing the paper does not bear those costs, that everybody else has to deal with it. And so internalizing those costs is one option. Dropping the information asymmetry somehow by better review or something like that is sort of the other classic solution there.